formally starting my talk on the topic as scheduled in the title, I think that it will be imperative for me to tell something about the background of the whole area on which I have been working for more than 30 years with my collaborator, Professor C Chattopadhyay, who is sitting just behind in front of me. And I should tell at least some of the necessary background. At the same time, I will try to give at least a formal definition of some of the technical notions which I will have to use several times in my talk. I will try my best. So we start with a topological space X. It is just a topological space S, no condition. And if we consider the set of all ring of all continuous functions from x to r. So this is just the set of all real value continuous functions from the topological space x to the r. It is a natural example of a commutative lattice ordered ring with identity. I should write commutative lattice ordered ring with identity. And there is a very specially constructed subring consisting of those functions which are bounded over x. It is the class of those continuous functions such that f is bounded over x. And this star x happens to constitute a subring as well as a sublattice of the parent ring Cx. And the ring operations are usual pointwise. There is a nice interaction between two apparently unconnected mathematical structures. One the topological structure of X, and the other the algebraic ring and lattice structure of both Cx and C star X. And this interaction has been addressed beautifully in a book which is known as a classic today, Gilman and Jerison, Rings of Continuous Functions. Now, if X is homeomorphic to Y, if X is homeomorphic to Y, then the ring Cx is isomorphic to Cy. This is just a classroom exercise. Anybody can do. Even a BSc student can do. But the problem is, suppose, so the first question I should ask is, if X and Y are two topological spaces whose rings of continuous functions are isomorphic, can we conclude that these two spaces are homeomorphic? In other words, can we determine uniquely the topological structure of X in terms of the corresponding algebraic structure of Cx? Answer is in general negative because of a very famous theorem of M.H. Stone. M.H. Stone, answer is no. There is a theorem of M.H. Stone which tells that given any topological space X, there exists a Tychonoff completely regular Hausdorff space Y such that Cx is isomorphic to Cy and C star X is isomorphic to C star Y. So in general, we cannot determine uniquely the topological structure of X via the algebraic structure of Cx. So let me ask the same question in a more refined language. Question is like this. Question 2.
if x and y are both trigonal and cx is isomorphic to cy, is then x is homeomorphic to y? Unfortunately, the answer is still negative. No. There is a famous counterexample. Space of all countable ordinals, omega 1. And the one-point compactification of the space of countable ordinals, these two spaces can never be homeomorphic simply because this space is non-compact, whereas this space is compact. In spite of the fact that there are rings of continuous functions are isomorphic. It's a very natural counterexample in that area. So, one of the major problems in this area can be phrased in the following language. So, this is yet another question. Can we set aside a nice class of spaces? Within which Cx is isomorphic to Cy will guarantee that x is homeomorphic to y. And that question was answered successfully in the year 1937 by M. H. Stone again. No name of M. H. Stone is associated with many deep problems in that area. And they have established a result which tells that if x and y are compact Hausdorff spaces, then they are homeomorphic if and only if the corresponding rings of continuous functions are isomorphic. And that theorem is known as Banach-Stone theorem. It's a famous theorem. Banach-Stone theorem. Why Banach? Because actually that particular result was established a little earlier in the year 1930. It was established by Banach himself, who has proved that if x and y are two compact metric spaces, and if I take a compact metric space x, then that cx is a Banach algebra. So if x and y are two compact metric spaces, such that the corresponding Banach algebras are isometric, isomorphic as Banach spaces, then the spaces are homeomorphic. M. H. Stone has improved this theorem. He realized that there is no need to assume any metric support of the topological space. So whenever x and y are two compact Hausdorff spaces, then x is homeomorphic to y if and only if cx is isomorphic to cy. Question still remains. Whenever a mathematician solves a question, immediately there emerges a different question. This process is going on and on. So the question is, can we improve this theorem? Is there an improved version of the same theorem available? Yes. That particular result has been superseded to a great extent in the year 1948 by a very eminent mathematician, Hewitt, who has proved that if this is Hewitt's theorem, if x and y are real compact spaces, I must define, then cx is isomorphic to cy, it will imply that x is homeomorphic to y. So I must define what is the real compact space. Anything else for that?
draw the diagram, this is just a tycoon of topological spaces in the entire rings of continuous functions. Without loss of generality, we can start with a tycoon of topological space because of a famous theorem of image stone. So X is just a tycoon of space. It is called real compact provided it can be embedded as a closed subset inside a power of copies of R. Formally, a space X is called real compact provided there is a homeomorphism. There is a topological embedding, more correctly, of X into a space like R to the power alpha, where alpha is a cardinal number. So essentially, products of powers of R and all their closed subspaces constitute the entire family of real compact spaces. Every compact space is real compact, but there are many, plenty examples of real compact spaces which are not compact. It turns out that every Lindelöf topological space is real compact. In particular, therefore, all the subspaces of the finite dimensional Euclidean spaces are in a real compact. But we know that only the closed and bounded subspaces of R in a compact, Borel-Lebesgue theorem. So, against this background, we can make a simple remark that the class of compact spaces is almost an insignificantly small subclass of the class of all real compact spaces. Almost every metrizable space is real compact. Almost every paracompact space is real compact. Rather, it is very difficult to construct an example of a good space. I call a space good provided it is tycoon of, because it is good in my purpose. So it is very difficult to construct an example of a tycoon of space which fails to be real compact. One example is space of all countable ordinals. So, in the context of that experience, that the real compact spaces, they are almost omnipresent, Hewitt's theorem is remarkable, that within the class of real compact spaces, we can determine uniquely a topological structure of a space via its algebraic ring structure. So natural question is, can we improve Hewitt's theorem further? Equivalently, can we discover a class of topological spaces which contains the class of real compact spaces as a proper subclass within which we can tell that Cx equal to Cy, it will imply x equal to y? Answer is no. That can be true. So in some sense, Hewitt's isomorphism theorem is a maximal theorem. A theorem may be called a maximal theorem provided that is the best possible theorem in that fashion. We cannot improve that theorem. Now, there is a close connection between real compact spaces, compact spaces, and pseudo-compact spaces. I have forgotten to define pseudo-compact. If a topological space, then X is called pseudo-compact. We know that if a topological space is compact, then every real continuous function is bounded. But we can ask a very simple question. Suppose X is a topological space on which it happens that every real valued continuous function is bounded, can we conclude that it is compact? No. A space X for which these two rings become identical in a different language, that space is called a pseudo-compact space. Every compact space is pseudo-compact. But there are many natural examples of pseudo-compact spaces which are not compact, space of all countable ordinals. That is an example of a pseudo-compact space, good space, that is a normal space also, the fourth space, which is not compact. So the class of all pseudo-compact spaces and the class of all real compact spaces, both are extensions of the class of all compact spaces, right? What is remarkable is that these two classes overlap exactly on the class of all compact spaces. So a pseudo-compact space is compact if and only if it is real compact. In other words, a real compact space is compact if and only if it is pseudo-compact. So in order to have a better insight into the structure of these three spaces, I will require some intervention of the Stone-Chick compactification of X. At least I will give a formal definition. The Stone-Chick compactification of X, it is just a compact Hausdorff space containing X as a dense subspace. We call this the compactification of X. So a compactification of a space is a compact Hausdorff space, because if it is not Hausdorff, it will not work smoothly. So some people call it Hausdorff compactification of X. So a compactification of X is a compact Hausdorff space in which X is embedded as a dense subspace, any compactification, and if it is Stone-Chick compactification, then surely X is embedded as a dense subspace with a very special remarkable extension property, which tells us that if we take any bounded continuous function, if we take a function f in systolic in our terminology, then that bounded continuous function has a continuous extension over the compactification as a real value continuous function. So this diagram describes the Stone-Chick compactification of X is a compactification of X which is enriched with a very special extension property, which tells that every bounded real value continuous function on X has a continuous extension over the compactification. Now suppose if I take an unbounded continuous function, what happens? I take a continuous function real valued on X which is possibly unbounded. That means I consider a topological space which is not pseudo-compact. It cannot have a continuous extension over the whole Stone-Chick compactification simply because beta X is compact. So therefore every real valued continuous function on beta X has to be bounded. So an unbounded real valued continuous function cannot be extended over the whole Stone-Chick compactification as a real valued continuous function. However, such a function f can be managed in a slightly different way. Let me explain. So whenever I take a function from X to R, then this R can be considered as a subspace of the one-point compactification of R, okay? Which is a compactive space, because R is locally compact. So any continuous function from X to R can be regarded as a continuous function from X to the one-point compactification of R. And there is a nice extension property of the Stone-Chick compactification, which I have not told you with its full power, which tells us that whenever this is the Stone-Chick compactification of X, not only every bounded real valued continuous function, but every compact Hausdorff valued continuous function on X can be extended to a continuous function on beta X, taking value from the same range compactive space. So if I use that powerful extension property, it follows that even if we take an unbounded real valued continuous function from X to R, it has a continuous extension to the Stone-Chick compactification. I can write in that manner, to the one-point compactification of R. So F belonging to CX, it will imply that it has a continuous extension from the Stone-Chick compactification, but this time may not be real value, one-point compactification value. So whenever there is an unbounded continuous function f, it follows that there is at least one point p on the growth of x in the Stone-Chick compactification. Points of beta x minus x are called points belonging to the growth of x in the Stone-Chick compactification. So corresponding to any unbounded real valued continuous function f, there is at least one point p for which f star p is not real. Okay. So it is a natural question. Can we gather all those points in the stone chip compactification at which the stone extension of all the continuous functions are real? This F star is called the stone extension. Okay. So let me just formally I use this notation. It is the collection of those points in the stone chip compactification such that F star P is real for all F in CX. So this constitutes the family of all those points in the stone chip compactification at which the stone extension of all the real valued continuous function is real. It turns out that such a special subset lies between X and the stone chip compactification. It further turns out that this is a real compact space. Something more can be told. This is the smallest real compact space lying between X and beta X. And X is real compact if and only if X is epsilon X. A smallest real compact space between X and beta X. And this is the largest subspace of beta x in which all the real valued continuous function on x can be continuously extended. And this particular epsilon x, it is called the Hewitt real compactification of x. And x equal to epsilon x if and only if x is real compact. What is remarkable is that so I have two different real compactification. Compactification is the real compact space. Compactification, because the compact space is real compact. One is stone chip compactification of X, and other the Hewitt real compactification of X. What is the relation between these three spaces? Relation is that X is real compact if and only if X is epsilon X told. X is pseudo compact if and only if the stone chip compactification and the Hewitt real compactification are identical. So if we combine these two results, what happens? The pseudo compact space is real compact if and only if it is compact, right? I will use certain notation for any subset A of CX. I will use that notation, epsilon AX. It is the collection of those points at which the stone extension of all the functions in A will be real. I repeat again. So with every subset A of AX, need not be subring, I can associate a particular subset of the stone chip compactification consisting precisely of those points at which the stone extension of all the functions in A will be real. It can be proved that it is a real compact space. So this is the real compact space lying between X and beta X. You can ask me a natural question. Whether every real compact space between X and beta X can be achieved through some subset of beta X? Yes, answer is yes. So all the real compact spaces in that region will be captured just by considering all possible subsets of CX and constructing the real compactification in this manner. But my question is a little different. So now let me come to my original topic. Possibly I will not be able to complete all of what is written. I will try to sketch some from the few things. Okay. So, in the theory of rings of continuous functions, I have told you the original ring CX and the subrings is star X. Two other rings, they have also received the attention of several mathematicians. I will just draw the diagram. This is the ring of continuous function This is the subring of real valued continuous functions. And there is yet another ring of continuous functions consisting of those sublings which has compact support. Right? What's the support of a function? If you take the closure of the complement of the zero set of the function, that is called the support of the function. So the zero set of a function is the set of all the points at which the function takes the value zero. And one more ring also has emerged, C infinity x. It's consisting of those continuous functions which vanish at infinity in a very special sense, which means that for every positive real number epsilon, the set of all the points where the function is numerically greater than equal to epsilon is a compact subset. It turns out that these two rings, ckx and c infinity x, if I draw the diagram correctly, ckx is a subring of c infinity x, which is a subring of sister x, which is a subring of cx. So there are four different rings. Now, these two rings have been used. These two rings have been used by several well-known mathematicians in this area. But one thing we want to draw your attention, that very few people have considered the internal ring structure of these two rings, ckx and c infinity x. Very few people. Right? And one of the reasons is that this, both these two rings, they lack identity. There is no identity element. And if a ring is devoid of identity, then that ring becomes in some sense powerless. Why? Because with the support of identity, we can establish some natural examples. For example, if a commutative ring has identity, every maximal ideal is prime. It's a very natural example. Every proper ideal can be extended to a maximal ideal. So we can ask a simple question, what happens to this very, very natural result if there is no identity in the element? And it can be proved that those results may fail if the ring is devoid of identity. In fact, there is a result which we have established some more than 10 years ago, Professor C Chattopadhyay is sitting, both of us, that if a ring, if a topological space X is locally compact and non-compact, and if the ring of continuous functions with compact support is not identical with the ring of continuous functions which vanish at infinity, then this ckx is a proper ideal of the ring c infinity x, unfortunately, which is not extendable to a maximal ideal. And also, we have observed that the structure space of a ring, what is the structure space? The structure space of a commutative ring is the set of all maximal ideals with the well-known Jarisky topology. The structure space of a commutative ring with identity is always a compact T1 topological space. But still here also, the identity plays a very crucial role. And it has been established that the structure space of the ring CKX is homeomorphic to the original topological space X, which is not compact. So the structure space, it ceases to be compact as because one is absent from this ring. Okay, I'll skip. Now, these two rings, ckx and c infinity x, a lot of works have been done, but they depend upon two apparently very simple facts, rings of continuous functions with compact support. Fact is that the union of two compact sets is compact. And every closed subset of a compact set is also compact. Sometimes we say that the family of compact subset makes an ideal of closed sets, not an ideal in the ring sense. So what is an ideal of closed sets? A family of closed sets is called an ideal if it is closed under finite union and if it is closed under closed subset taken from the family of closed sets. So if I take the family of all the compact subsets, then that makes a very natural example of an ideal of closed sets. Now, with every ideal P of closed sets, we can associate the set of all the continuous functions whose support belongs to P. Right? And that support is also an ideal of the original ring CX. So if you take P to be the ideal of compact sets, then this CPX is identical with the ring of continuous functions with compact support. We shall show that any ideal of closed sets in X that can generate a natural real compact space between X and beta X. Let me explain. So, and please recall that for any subset A of CX, I have explained, I have written a symbol like this, epsilon AX, consisting of those points of the stone check compactification at which the stone extension of all the functions in AX is real. And that epsilon AX is a real compact space lying between X and beta X. So in particular, if we take the ideal CPX, this is an ideal of the ring CX, that P is an ideal of the family of closed sets. So if we take epsilon CPX, it means the collection of those points P in the stone check compactification at which the stone extensions of all the functions belonging to the CPX is real. And so that is also a real compact space. So given an ideal P of closed sets, we have defined this space X to be P compact, provided X is identical with epsilon PX. Question is, every P compact space is real compact, it can be proved. And a compact space is P compact. Whenever P is contained in Q, P and Q are both ideals, and X is P compact, then X is Q compact. So we have raised a natural question. This is a natural question. Suppose X is a non-compact real compact space. There are many examples of non-compact real compact space. Question is, can we produce an ideal of P of closed sets in AX for which X is P compact and that P is minimal? So given a real compact non-compact space X, can we construct in some way an ideal P of closed sets in X which is minimal in some sense for which X is P compact? And that question have been answered some 7 years ago. The calculus answer is negative. So if X is a non-compact P compact space and where P is an ideal of closed sets in X, then there is always an ideal R of closed sets in X as R is properly contained in P and X is R compact. So the answer to the question is negative. So it means that we can always define, we can always interpolate a strictly decreasing sequence of ideal of closed sets in X for which X is PI compact. So this gives a hierarchy of real compact spaces. I skip the proof of this result. So given an ideal P of closed sets in X, epsilon CPX, I explain again, consisting of those points P in beta X, at least the stone extension of P is real for every F in CPX. It is a real compact space lying between X and beta X. So the question is quite natural. I will try to answer this question. Then suppose X is a diagonal of space, is it possible that every real compact space between X and beta X could be achieved by some ideal of closed sets in X? So given any ideal of closed sets, that can induce, that can define a real compact space between X and beta X by some natural formula. So I ask the reverse question. Whether every real compact space between X and beta X could be achieved as a real compactification induced by a suitable ideal of closed sets in X? Answer is in some sense remarkable that every real compact space between X and beta X, it could be achieved by an ideal of closed sets if and only if X is pseudo-compact. So incidentally, this gives a characterization of pseudo-compact spaces. In fact, one part of the theorem is trivial. Which part? That if X is pseudo-compact, have told you that Jewitt-Real compactification and the Stone-Check compactification are identical. So whenever X is pseudo-compact, beta X is the only real compact space lying between X and beta X. And that can be achieved by the ideal of all compact sets. So that part is trivial. So the non-trivial part is, if I shall show that, I will try to give a sketch of proof of this result, that if X is not pseudo-compact, then we will be able to define a real compact space lying between X and the Stone-Check compactification, which can never be achieved through an ideal of closed sets. A little bit technically, I'm sorry. So, to prove the other part of this theorem, I want to record some of the results related to C-type ring. What is a C-type ring? A ring is called C-type if it is isomorphic to a ring of the form CY for some type of space X. Cx is a C-type ring, trivial. In fact, C star X, the ring of all bounded continuous functions, is a C-type ring. Because C star X is isomorphic to C beta X, where beta X is the Stone-Check compactification of X, the famous Gelfand-Kolmogorov theorem. So Cx is a C-type ring, trivial. C star X is a C-type ring. We have raised the following question, which rings are C-type? It's a very wide question. So let me confine myself to asking a very few moderate version of the same question. Which rings lying between C star X and Cx is a C-type ring? Such a ring is called an intermediate ring. We have given an answer to this question with the help of one of my students, Dipendude, who is a friend of Indrajit, he's a colleague. Now, before answering this question, I shall define a binary relation between the intermediate rings. So given any two, what is an intermediate ring? A ring lying between C star X and Cx is an intermediate ring, okay. So given any two intermediate rings, Ax and Bx, we say that they are related, provided they can generate the same real compactification, epsilon X. So any intermediate ring can generate a real compact space lying between X and beta X. That we may call the real compactification induced by the intermediate ring. So, two intermediate rings are related if and only if they generate the same real compactification. Can we prove that that binary relation this is the family of all the intermediate rings, sigma x. Into so many disjoint equivalence classes. Okay. It turns out that C star X is the lone member of its own equivalence class. Okay. C star X is the lone member of its equivalence class. That means if we take any subring of CX which contains properly C star X, then that cannot generate the real compactification induced by C star X. What is the real compactification induced by C star X? Just the Stone-Check compactification. So the Stone-Check compactification is induced exclusively by the ring of all bounded continuous functions. And we are just telling the same fact in a slightly different language. So C star X is the lone equivalence class modulo this relation. It turns out that every equivalence class has the largest member. Each equivalence class has a largest member, and that largest member happens to be a C-type ring. What is remarkable is that the converse is true. That means each of the equivalence class, excepting this special one, it contains infinitely many intermediate rings. There is a largest ring in every equivalence class. That largest ring is a C-type ring. And that is the only C-type ring belonging to that equivalence class. So that is a characterization. So what is a C-type ring? A C-type ring is an intermediate ring which happens to be the largest member of the corresponding equivalence class generated by this equivalence relation. Now, if we use that relation, then it can be proved that every subset between Every subset of the stone check compactification, then that can generate a C-type ring. How? If we take any subset T of beta x, and if we take all those continuous functions whose stone extension at every point of T is real, then that turns out to be a C-type ring. And that is just a corollary of the above result. Okay. So every subset of the stone check compactification can generate a C-type ring. Remarkably, the converse is true. So whenever I take a C-type ring, then that can be defined through a subset of the Stone-Check compactification. So I just give a summary. If we take any subset T of beta x, you just consider all those continuous functions whose stone extension at every point of T is real, then that is a ring in between sister x and cx, and that is a C-type ring. So, in some sense, that is a natural formula for the generation of C-type rings. So, there is one result I will require. And this is a result established by three Spanish mathematicians, Dominguez, Gomez, and Romero. They have given a very nice formula for generating C-type rings. If you take any ideal I of the ring of continuous functions, take the linear sum of sister x plus I, algebraic sum. So that is a very natural example of a C-type ring. Now, we shall give two answers in the same question. My original question is whether every real compact space between x and beta x can be achieved through an ideal of closed sets. Let me ask once again the question in connection with Dominguez's result. That if you take any ideal I of the ring Cx, then sister x plus I, that is a very natural formula for giving a C-type ring. Can we produce any other C-type ring? Can we construct any other C-type ring which is not generated by this formula? These two questions are the common answer that this we can do if and only x is pseudo-compact. Okay, just give a sketch of the proof. So, my original hypothesis is that suppose x is not pseudo-compact. X is not pseudo-compact. What I will do, we shall construct a real compact space lying between x and beta x, which can never be achieved through an ideal of closed sets in x. Since x is not pseudo-compact, there is a result that the space is pseudo-compact if and only if it cannot contain a copy of n. Copy of n means just a homeomorphic copy of the space of natural numbers, which is C embedded in X. What is C embedded in X? That means a set is called C embedded in X provided every real valued continuous function on that set can be extended to a real valued continuous function over the whole X. So since X is not pseudo-compact, it contains just a copy of n, a countably infinite discrete subset, which is C embedded in X, on which every real valued continuous function can be extended continuously over the whole of X. Now what do you do? We just make a partition of the set of all natural numbers into a countable number of countably infinite sets. This we can do by just exploiting the fact that there are infinitely many prime integers. Okay. So n is equal to the union of nk. This is just a partition of n into a countable number of countably infinite sets. We know that each of nk is C embedded in X because n is just a discrete topological space. X is C embedded in the Hewitt real compactification epsilon of X. I have defined epsilon X, right? I have told once again that epsilon X is a space lying between x and beta x on which we can extend every real valued continuous function. So in our technical notion, x is C embedded in epsilon x, nk is C embedded in x because nk is just a discrete subset. So nk is C embedded in epsilon x. Okay. And there is a result that if I take a countable C embedded subset of a tricon of space, then that is a closed subset. The simple exercise in Gilman direction spoke. So therefore that nk is a closed subset of the Hewitt real compactification of X. Just want to draw a diagram. say stone is a compact equation of x. This is a Jewish real compact equation of x. I make a partition. This is n1. This is n2. This is n3, on and on. What I do? Please see that this nk is closed in epsilon x because it is C embedded in epsilon x and it is a countable subset. So every countable subset, every countable C embedded subset of a type of space is a closed subset, the standard result I use. So this nk is closed in epsilon x. For example, this n1 is closed in epsilon x. Let's please see that n1 is never closed in beta x because beta x is compact, n1 is infinite, x, but never closed in beta x. So there must be some portion of the closure of n1 inside this region. I may call it closure of n1 in beta x minus epsilon x. Something like this. There is no limit point of n1 in x. Even there is no limit point of n1 in this epsilon x. But still it has limit points in Schoenstatt compact relation. Where are they situated? Belonging to this zone. This zone is called the zone of hyperreal points. Right? So if I take the closure of n1 in beta x, what are the points of the closure? The points of n1. What are the limit points of n1? The points belonging to the closure of n1 in this beta x minus epsilon x zone. I have written the diagram. It can be proved that any two disjoint zero subsets in any Tychon of space have their closure in the Schoenstatt compact relation of the disjoint. So whenever z1 and z2 are two disjoint zero sets in x, then the closure of z1 and closure of z2 are disjoint in the Schoenstatt compact relation, standard result. So the closure of n1, I can write that the closure of n1 and closure of n2 in beta x, they are disjoint simply because n1 and n2 are disjoint in x. So this extra portion, this is the closure of nk, this is the closure of nk in beta x minus epsilon x. So whenever n1 and n2 are different, their closures in beta x minus epsilon x are also disjoint. What I will do? I will explain. I just choose a point p1 from the closure of beta x in n1 in epsilon x. Pairwise disjoint non-empty closed subsets. So for each point k, I choose a point pk belonging to the closure of nk in the Schoenstatt compact equation and which is a limit point without being a point. And I just gather all those points and I call this a T. It is the set consisting of the countable number of points p1, p2, etc. What I do in the next stage? I consider those continuous functions whose stone extension at all the points t will be real. And by our old formula, that Ct is a C-type intermediate ring. Because if you take any subset of the Schoenstatt compact equation, and if you gather all those continuous functions whose stone extension at all those points are real, then that is going to constitute a C-type ring. I call it Ct. So Ct is a C-type ring. It is just a C-type intermediate ring. Now what I will do, I will first show that it can be checked, I skip, that there does not exist any ideal I of the ring Cx such that Ct can be expressed as the linear sum of C star x and I. I just skip the argument, which we have proved by making some contrapositive argument. So it can be proved that Ct is never equal to C star x for I to for any ideal I of Cx. Now I will complete. What is my intention? Please recall, because we are lost in so many technicalities.
My originally I started with the non-pseudo-compact topological space X. What I used to do? I will try to construct a real compact space lying between X and beta X, which I can never achieve through any ideal of closed sets. Right? I just remind you of this. So Ct is not equal to C star X plus I, where T is just the collection of all those points belonging to the hyperreal zone. So what I will do again to complete my theorem, I will start my argument in a contradictory manner. If possible, we shall prove that the real compact space, so the, I have constructed my Ct, then let me construct epsilon Ct. What is epsilon Ct? It is the collection of those points on the Stone-Check compactification at which all the functions in Ct have their Stone extension real. We shall show that this epsilon Ct, it cannot be expressed in the form epsilon Cpx. So this is my final target. So T is the set of all the points p1, p2, pn. I constructed Ct, the set of those continuous functions whose Stone extension at these points are real, and in the next stage, what I do, epsilon Ct. So there are three stages. I first construct T, then Ct, then epsilon Ct, containing those points in the Stone-Check compactification at which all the continuous functions in Ct will take real value. And this is the real compact space by our earlier observations. We shall show that this real compact space cannot be expressed through any ideal P of closed sets. Once I can prove that, then the theorem will be completed. How I have proved? Just a few minutes arguments. If possible, let there be an ideal P of closed sets in X such that epsilon Ct equal to epsilon Cpx. Okay. So it follows that epsilon Ctx, that means the real compactification generated by the family Ct, is identical with epsilon Cp plus C star Xx. We know that if we take all the real value bounded continuous function, their Stone extension will always be real at any point in beta x. So I can write that epsilon Cp plus C star X and epsilon Ct are identical.
Excuse me, try to find to finish in 2 minutes.
Right. I'll surely try. So this means that this Ct and Cp plus C star X, you just look at this formula, both of which is a C-type ring by our earlier results, and they belong to the same equivalence class of sigma x modulo this binary relation. So both are C-type rings, both belong to the same equivalence class. So both are the largest members of the equivalence classes, because the only C-type rings are the largest member. So it follows that this Ct is identical with Cpx plus C star X, which is a contradiction. We have proved in the earlier step that this Ct can never be expressed in such a manner. And that contradiction tells me that this result is true. For any tichon of space X, it is pseudo-compact if and only if I can achieve any C-type intermediate ring by virtue of the beautiful formula of domain weight, C star X plus I, if and only if every real compact space between X and beta X could be achieved through some ideal V of closed sets in X by some natural formula. I believe I have been able to finish within the stipulated period.
Okay, thank you for your very good talk.